Station, this is Houston. Are you ready for the event?
Houston, this is Station. We are ready for the event.
ABC News Digital, this is Mission Control Houston. Please call Station for a voice check.
Hey, Space Station, this is John at ABC Digital. Can you hear me okay?
Hi, John. I got you loud and clear. How me?
Great. Thank you very much. We have a couple-second delay here. We're just going to count it off now. So if you could answer with anything. What did you have for breakfast this morning?
Scrambled eggs and ham.
Beautiful. We're going to have about a seven-second delay, just so you know. So we're going to make sure we don't talk over you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hi, Scott. This is Blair Schiff from ABC News. Thanks for joining us today.
Hi, Blair. It's great to be talking with you.
Great. So you've been described as a rookie astronaut for this flight, but we're all aware that it takes a great deal of preparation needed to become an astronaut. So what does your rookie flight feel like thus far?
It's been absolutely phenomenal. Very exciting, very well worth the years of training, and very well worth the patience and waiting for it to happen.
Also, I have to ask, since you're from Massachusetts, which, as you know, recently got hit with that wicked bomb cyclone of a winter storm, could you even see it from up there?
Oh, absolutely. We can see the big picture weather patterns as we fly over, depending on the orbits that we're in at the time. But it was a monster for sure.
It was such a mess. So I have to ask, in 2016, 50% of NASA's latest class of astronauts was female. We're sure that there have been so many influential astronauts in your career thus far. So who would you say your number one female astronaut is and why?
Well, I'm really glad you asked me that. My number one female astronaut hero is Dr. Shannon Lucid. She came to NASA a long time ago, late 80s, and has done some phenomenal work. She's flown five times, and on her fifth flight, the space shuttle dropped her off at the Russian space station Mir, and she spent some time on Mir. And she went through 2 years or 3 years of training out in Star City before we were all doing it. So she was one of the trailblazers for that program, and it's absolutely phenomenal what she's accomplished.
So if you got to talk to her right now, what would you tell her? What would you say is what was so inspirational for you from her?
I would just say thank you. You know, thank you for the patience and the perseverance to blaze the trail through the training programs and through the operational programs to actually get up on station and start building the international partnerships, start building those bonds, and to start creating the program that has come to be this engineering marvel that we're on today, the International Space Station.
And also, correct me if I'm wrong, we saw you had three kids, including a daughter. And since our audience is mainly female, we were wondering, how does your daughter inspire you every day?
All my kids inspire me every day, without a doubt. And she is absolutely wonderful, caring individual. And she inspires me by her work ethic and by her perseverance. She sets her sights on very specific goals, and she goes for it, and she doesn't give up until she gets there. And it's very, very wonderful to watch.
So if you were speaking to women today who may be interested in getting involved in NASA or the space program in general, what would you advise for them to set their sights on, for them to set their goals? What's your advice you'd give to these young ladies?
I give the same advice to everybody. Pick a discipline that you really enjoy working in. NASA has needs for all kinds of all disciplines. The STEM program would actually help get into the an astronaut program. And technical help obviously are more jobs. But I would say pick a discipline, work really hard at it, and do well, and don't give up.
Great. So what kind of greater perspective do you gain by flying high above the Earth?
Well, the perspective that most of us get when we get up here is how small and how fragile the Earth is in the big expanse of the universe. And, you know, one of the things I like to look at are sunrises. And when you see, you're in the blackness of night on the space station and you're looking towards the velocity vector and where we're going, you can just see a thin blue ring. And it really highlights the coming of a new day. It highlights the promise that brings. And you can really see how thin our atmosphere really is and how beautiful our planet is as the sun goes through the process of coming into full view.
I have to ask, with you being up there so long, how do you even get started packing for a journey like this?
Well, fortunately, we have a lot of folks that have done this before me, and what we can bring is very limited and very standardized, so that we know how to pack it, how to weigh it, how to get the right masses to the right people that do the computations, because we have to fly it up here on a rocket, which can get expensive. So, you know, we come up with a certain amount of clothes. We come up with a certain amount of food based on calories per day. And then we have a small allotment of personal things that we can bring. And assuming that we can get through the safety process okay, so we're not going to bring any fire hazards up to the space station or any atmospheric type hazards, plastics that might off gas or things like that, then that's about how it goes. But we pack very little.
I'm glad to hear you didn't sneak a sandwich like a couple astronauts did before you. Beyond that, I'm wondering if you had one book that you could bring up there, what's one book you would bring up and why?
Well, I'm a systems thinker. I happen to like the Fifth Discipline by Peter Senge. And it's just a neat book, helps keep things in perspective. And keeps my systems thinking processes sharp.
All right, and then last question for you. What's the first thing you're going to do when you return in June?
I believe I'm going to take a nice hot shower.
That is a very good answer. I would miss showering, too. Anything else you wanted to mention to us?
No, just thank you so much for the interest, and to the folks out there that follow the space program, thank you so much, and don't forget to dream big.
Thank you so much, Scott. I really appreciate your time, and you stay safe up there and come up with some amazing inventions for us. How about that?
You bet. I'm all over it. Thank you.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the ABC News digital portion of the event. Please stand by for a voice check from space.com.
Hi, this is space.com. Hello?
Hello, I hear you loud and clear. How me?
Great, I can hear you too. So, we're speaking with NASA astronaut and first-time flyer Scott Tingle, calling space.com live from the International Space Station. So you've been in space for a month now. How do you like it?
I absolutely love it. It's the most phenomenal place I've ever visited, I've ever lived, or worked. I love it.
What's the most surprising thing about living in space?
Well, I guess the most surprising thing is that it's not that much different from living on Earth, with the exception of you get to float around everywhere you go. I guess the thing that I had to work on the most was making sure the food that I wanted to get into my mouth got to my mouth and stays in my mouth and doesn't go everywhere else. So a little bit of work there.
Aha, you have had some interesting chases, perhaps, based around that.
Oh, a little bit. Every once in a while, you're reaching into your soup bag to get some soup, and it sticks to your spoon pretty good. But if you move your spoon in the wrong way, it all comes off your spoon and goes flying all over the place, and you have to clean it up. So you got to be really careful, and you get used to it after a while.
Sounds like some precision work. So are you looking forward to your spacewalk coming up?
Absolutely. We just spent the morning preparing. We just did a suit check and made sure everything was working right and make sure everything was fitting right. And we're going to spend the rest of the time now for configuring our tools and studying procedures so that when we go outside, we can be really efficient and make it happen. But this is going to be a lifetime memory for sure. And I'm looking forward to getting out there and fixing up the systems that we'll be working on.
So you've had the chance to try out those tools on the ground. Is that right?
Absolutely. We have an extensive training program at our neutral buoyancy lab, and we get to use all the tools and pretty much have good simulations of all the systems inside the pool, which is with neutral buoyancy.
Okay. So are you planning to look at the moon while Earth is seeing a lunar eclipse in late January?
I'm going to try. Sometimes our schedules get kind of busy, but I'm going to try to work out the timing, and I got to get in and see where the orbits will have us. But it'll be a very interesting picture if we could kind of get everything all together and make it happen. So it's on my list of things to do.
Speaking of which, is there anything that you're hoping to photograph from space that you're still waiting on?
I haven't had a whole lot of chances since I've been up here to take pictures. I'm hoping after the EVAs things will slow down a little bit and I can do a little bit more time taking pictures. I got a list of targets that I'd like to take pictures of, hometowns, places that I've gone to school, and different places that I've visited while in the Navy or in other jobs that I've had. So, I'm really looking forward to getting those on film.
And speaking of the moon, a new space policy directive tasks NASA with returning to the moon. Would you want to go?
Absolutely. I'll leave from here if they let me.
I guess it would be a nicer transition to go to 1/6 gravity before heading back to Earth.
You bet. That sure would. It would be fun. That would be a great mission.
And so you have a lot of time and space ahead of you. What's one thing that you definitely want to do that you haven't had a chance to try yet?
Well, it's the spacewalk, and that's coming up here on Tuesday. And so hopefully we'll get a chance to try that and fix everything up.
Is there any wait time built into that spacewalk where you'll be able to take a look at Earth?
They have a little time, we call it adaptation time, where we go out and we can just kind of get our bearings right, and we kind of get adjusted and what kind of forces we need to move our body around out in with the suit on. So we will have a little bit of time, and invariably there's 5 or 10 minutes here, in between tasks where we're kind of waiting for things to catch up and waiting to start the next task. So I do expect a little bit of time to just kind of look down at the Earth and look up at the stars and the moon and whatever else we can see there.
I know it's a little hard to predict in advance, but what do you think is the trickiest thing you guys are going to have to do on this spacewalk?
Well, there's a point in the spacewalk where I have to get out of my boot restraint, and I have to go over to my partner's boot restraint, and I have to move him while he's holding a massive piece of equipment from the robotic arm. So there's a lot of mass there, and we have to be very careful about what kind of rates we put while we're moving that moving his body around. So I think that'll be tricky. I'll probably take that slow and be very cautious.
All right, thanks. And are you looking forward to the not while you're there, but just in general, looking forward to the commercial crew program making its first test flights to the space station?
I sure am. That's a phenomenal program. It should be really a great day when we start flying our vehicles from Kennedy Space Center again. And I think 2018 to 2019 are going to be some great years.
All right. And sorry, I lost track of my thing here, but if you've gotten your space legs already, are you able to do any interesting flips or maneuvers as you move around the space station?
What I like, you know, when I'm coming through the lab and get on a good straightaway, I kind of like to tap a little bit of roll into my body, so I pretend I'm doing barrel rolls in my airplanes, and it's kind of fun to do that. That's my favorite maneuver, but you know, everybody else, I think, you know, you can see them doing backflips and forward flips, and some folks translate sitting down, and some folks, you know, translate lying down, you know, flat and horizontal. But it's a really neat place to try to move around in.
All right, and I guess my last thing is, what are you looking forward to most when you get back to Earth?
Getting back to Earth, I'm really looking forward to seeing my family and friends. I'll have been gone for 7 or 8 months, and it'll be nice to catch up with all of them for that. And then right after that, I got a couple of Dalmatians that I haven't seen for a while. It's going to be really good to catch up with those and bring them out for a run. And then after that, a nice hot shower.
That sounds great. Thank you so much for talking with us, Scott, and good luck on your spacewalk.
Thank you, and thank you so much for your interest. Have a great day.
Station, this is Houston ACR. That concludes the event.
Thank you, all participants from ABC News Digital and Space.com. Station, we are now resuming operational audio communications.